HarperCollins presents Good Grief, Embracing Life at a Time of Death, written and read by Catherine Mayer and Anne Mayer Bird. To Andy and John, with our undying love. Forward. A woman accosts me in a supermarket. She tells me we've met once before, when I leafleted her street during an election campaign. I'm surprised she recognises me in my pandemic outfit of peaked cap, sunglasses and face mask, and even more so by the turn the conversation takes. She compliments me on Good Grief, then says, "Catherine, I want your life." This isn't an obvious reaction to a book I never wanted to write about things I hope never to experience, the agony of loss in the teeth of a global crisis. My stepfather John and husband Andy died at the start of the pandemic. Lockdown forced my mother and me to grieve in solitude. The story we tell through my memoir and in my mother's accompanying letters is not one you'd expect to inspire envy. True, we write with a brimming awareness of how lucky we are to have loved and be loved, and neither of us underestimates a gift concealed under layers of pain. The mirroring of our experiences gives us a strange and perfect understanding of what the other thinks and feels. The notion of someone yearning to change places with me, nevertheless, forces a snort of laughter from behind my mask. Hay fever, I lie, dropping a value pack of toilet rolls into my shopping trolley. Life must go on. The woman continues unfazed. She has come to doubt that relationships are worth the pain of their ending. Though she has never lost a partner to death, fractured romances have left her grieving in a different way. This book has convinced her to live fully again. If that is its lesson, then my mother and I are pupils, not teachers. Every day we grapple with the question of how to rebuild lives so thoroughly altered that even smaller habits and routines no longer make sense. In recounting our stumbling progress, we hope to ease conversations around death and dying and the long aftermath for those of us left behind. There's so much we wish we'd known. When first our publisher asked us to document our experiences, we decided not to censor ourselves but to share the bleakly, blackly funny stuff, the craziness, other people's and our own. How brave you are, we bereaved are often told, as if we chose this test of character or haven't just been sobbing over the silliest of things. It also seemed important to tell our stories with immediacy, rather than hindsight. I wrote most of Good Grief in the first 8 months of my widowhood. The dates on my mother's earliest letters show that she had scarcely more time to find her feet. In preparing this new edition, due out exactly 2 years after Andy's death, I worked to retain the integrity of that original writing, making only small changes for clarity on timelines and thoroughly revising just one existing chapter. I submitted the first version when COVID vaccines appeared both a distant prospect and a possible endgame. The updated chapter about the transformations COVID inflicted on my family and the world reflects a more nuanced reality. The main changes to the book are additions, 2 entirely new chapters and 5 additional letters covering the transition into the second pandemic year, and an intermediate phase of grief as widely misjudged by the grieving as the wholehearted. In its early months, grief is understood as a sea of tears. Any signs of coping, or perish the thought, having fun, prompt suspicion in onlookers, guilt in the bereaved. Soon enough, however, far too soon, the pendulum swings the other way. These days, my mother and I notice that our sadness is perceived as a mark of failure to process and proceed. People urge us to set it aside, as if the lovely dead belong to the receding past and are not, and will not always be, our present and future too. We are also now able to share details and insights that at the time of first printing had not yet come into sharp enough focus to articulate, or felt too sensitive to discuss. One of the new chapters, for example, recounts how a rupture between Andy and one of his oldest and closest friends played out after his death. Another examines the way in which the physical impacts of grief lag behind its emotional punch. My mother's letters reflect a trajectory that will be familiar to many bereaved, of peaks and troughs rather than a steady path to a better place. Be in no doubt, though, she and I are in a better place. The first edition of Good Grief predicted this course. This edition justifies our optimism. In that respect, the woman who accosted me is right to covet my life. When its old version was still intact, my deepest fear was losing Andy. My mother would have said the same about John. Then the worst thing either of us could imagine happened, and their deaths came wrapped in horrors nobody foresaw. Even so, in a phrase my mother often uses, we are still here. Our days and hearts are full. Our lives will never be the same, but will always be better for the joy that transfigured them. Grief is our companion, not our curse. Introduction. We are extraordinarily lucky, my mother and I. We have each other and we have this room. When she and John moved to London, married just 3 years and still figuring out the shape of their relationship, their new home had not yet established its boundaries either. The room came later. At first, the house grew warily as they added a small glass extension at the back with a slippery incline that their ginger cat treated as a slide. The local foxes chose a bigger playing field, barking and tumbling on the flat roof of the builder's merchant abutting the property, a comparatively recent arrival to this estate of Victorian townhouses. The neighbourhood had seen wealthier days and would do so again. Nothing stays the same, no matter how solid it appears. In a portent of gentrification, developers made plans to demolish the commercial unit next door and build in its stead a new house made to look old. My mother and stepfather debated what to do. They had more than enough space already, yet they feared that a new neighbour sharing a party wall might prove noisy, and anyway, John wanted somewhere to put a piano and the art that he had started to make and collect. After 5 decades working in jobs he didn't much enjoy, a lifetime, he said, though it proved to be just 3/5 of his total span, he retired and began to reinvent himself as a painter. They bought the unit and knocked through the party wall, creating for themselves a garage, utility area, extra bathroom, and this, a cavernous second living room. If truth be told, and the conversations my mother and I conduct in this room often worm out truths unknown to either or both of us until the moment of utterance, I never until recently warmed to this room. Its industrial proportions make it a perfect place to display paintings or throw big parties. It is less successful as a venue for intimate discussions. 2 big armchairs maintain a chilly distance against the far wall, acknowledging each other only with a slight angling that directs the gaze of any occupants towards the centre of the room and beyond that emptiness to a Chesterfield at the opposite wall. This is where my tiny mother usually sits during our weekly meetings, Thumbelina on the full-size sofa. After John died and my husband Andy stunned us by following suit 41 days later, she and I saw each other often, but at varying intervals. It was the lockdown against coronavirus, coming 7 weeks after Andy's death, that enforced on our timetable a form and regularity. New government rules to combat the unfolding pandemic isolated us in our fresh isolation. My mother, who had never in almost 9 decades lived on her own, and me, alone again after 29 years of coalescence. Only when Andy had gone did I realise how much he and I resembled a sight we often stopped to admire on our weekend walks. A tree and railing merged into a single entity, the tree enfolding, the railing sustaining. Exposed now and unsupported, I looked for fresh ways to hold myself up. The imperative to help out my mother came not as a burden, but, like the small services I performed for others in those early lockdown days, supplying food and medicine, posting parcels, as a gift. In doing these things, I found the iron necessary to stay upright. More than that, my Sunday visits to my mother, legitimate under the rules as care work, provided the only meaningful face-to-face interactions I would have during that period, even if the lower halves of our faces were masked. Through three lockdowns, this continued, and even now we maintain our routines. Every second Sunday I change her duvet. Most weeks I fix, or try to fix, something. An iPad one visit, a recalcitrant filing cabinet the next, and bring meals I've prepared to her requests. Cauliflower cheese was an early favourite. Latterly we've been exploring curries. There are often other items to source too. Shoes, hanging files, birthday cards. She presents me with a to-do list when I arrive. She calls it an agenda, and we work through it. Then, at the end of my visit, we allow ourselves to relax, she on the sofa, me in one of the distant chairs, and we talk. Our starting point is usually a piece of news from the past week, whether small and personal or global and transformative. These things are anyway linked in unexpected ways. In the first months of widowhood, our battles to persuade service providers to transfer household accounts into our names dragged on as the virus and furlough schemes depleted staff numbers. Automated systems failed the easiest of tests. How can I help you today, Andrew? I'm Andrew's widow, Andrew's dead. Oh dear, Andrew, that doesn't sound good. For the worst part of the past 2 years, Facebook has shown me advertisements for funeral services as if the mischance that saw me notifying John's friends of his death in December 2019, organising his exequies at Golders Green Crematorium in January 2020, Andy's cremation at the same venue less than a month later on Valentine's Day, and his memorial at the beginning of that March, bespeaks a delicious new pastime. The same algorithms that take me for a funeral hobbyist and, more recently, pester me to join Facebook's dating service, also decide which posts are seen by whom, which propaganda to channel to voters. They may have helped install the populist leaders in the US, Brazil, and here in the UK, who responded to COVID not with life-saving policies, but bluster and blarney. In the big room with its gallery of paintings, the early meetings with my mother unfolded against another grim backdrop, both strange and horribly familiar. As the global toll of the virus rose, we couldn't help but understand each death, not as a statistic, but a sequence of events, a body shutting down, the person there, and then not there, never again there, the families distraught and numb, embarking on the same path that we already tread. Bereavement is an odd phenomenon, full of twists and surprises, nasty ambushes and unexpected dark humour. It is the little things that knock you off course. I work dry-eyed through snowdrifts of sadmin, only to weep inconsolably when the Wi-Fi conks out. One day I call the funeral director to pay by credit card for Andy's cremation. The man in the accounts department runs through the usual drill: name, credit card number, expiry date. For a second, I genuinely don't know whether he means for the card or my beloved. Laughter, inappropriate and all the harder to control for that fact, wells up. The man takes my thickened voice as a sign of grief. For days afterwards, I find myself sniggering. We are aware, my mother and I, that we discomfort well-wishers. Most people are scared to death of death and unsure how to talk about it. Yet curiously, our composure unnerves them more than tears. We appear functional and less fragile than they expect. Might our similar reactions and coping mechanisms point to universalities about grief and loss, or to the specifics of our family's history and culture? We don't know, but assume a mixture of both. As a child, my mother lost her father and brother in quick succession. When my sisters and I were children, the stepfather she loved took his own life. These experiences surely shaped her and her parenting, informing my own conspicuous self-sufficiency, which Andy sometimes found difficult. Oh, my love.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.